he doesn't quite get, and nobody liked it. You know, I was like the only voice out there.
Like the bounce, so we're now doing the bounce?
Yeah, no, the bounce is great. It's great. And it's California, so, you know, yeah. Hopefully it's going to last for a little bit. And there was some incredibly beautiful posters, small little ones, mm-hmm. From Bergman. They were doing all these Bergman posters. Oh, just, I'm a big Bergman fan. And, oh, my God, I just thought, okay, I've got to go and buy some of those, you know, more stuff. Nerakhoon, yeah, which means betrayal in Laos, which means those who betray. And we had wanted to call the film Nerakhoon because it's a very strong word in Lao, mm-hmm. but it's very difficult for people to know how to pronounce it. Yeah. And so, but I also felt like it was very strong to say the betrayal, mm-hmm. And the betrayal as opposed to the betrayals, because I really wanted people to be able to understand and to discover for themselves, you know, the many betrayals in the movie. Mm-hmm. And
so you wanted them to be surprised, but because that was one of the conversations, seeing it with other people, that, you know, the obvious betrayal of the United States of Laos, but then there are all kinds of betrayals within the picture as well.
Correct, right. That filter all the way down to the bonds of the family. And you see that, you know, something which is a political event or a political occurrence mm-hmm. has such ramifications to us personally and how we are as people and how betrayal on a large scale, you know, continues for years afterwards, yeah. You know.
Hangs over these people pretty heavily. And how did you go, when did you jump into this? I mean, it's watching the film, it's hard to figure out exactly when you started shooting and stopped, you know, kind of putting back together the pieces of their life back in Laos.
Well, I started filming it quite a long time ago, and it's interesting because people say to me after they've seen the film, it's like, oh my God, and, you know, how did you get that material? And I said, I was there, I filmed it, you know. And but it's interesting because I became a cinematographer, and as you know, I'm a mm-hmm. director of photography, and I started shooting because of this film. Years and years ago when I decided that I wanted to make this film as a young photojournalist and as someone who got to know the Lao through the neighborhood that I was working in, because I lived in Providence, Rhode Island, where I went to school at Brown, and I saw all these people coming into the neighborhood, and they were wearing their traditional clothes, and these were the Hmong who are from the highlands of Laos. And I started talking to them as much as I could, and they could hardly speak any English, if any, and they were carrying their chickens, and was very interested in what happened to them and why they were here, and was struck by the anomaly of the fact that, you know, we, the United States, had abandoned their country during the war, and what we don't know is that the Vietnam War actually started in Laos, and that we waged a war there, and to this day, the United States has never really officially recognized that we've fought a war there, and I find that incredible. But the fact that these people were here because of the war, and that kind of drew me into this, you know, questions of identity and who these people were and how they would, you know, how they would deal with America and how the Americans would deal with them. So
your first credit on IMDb actually is for somebody else's film about Laotians.
No? Actually, it's about Cambodia.
Cambodia, okay.
Yeah, that was the first kind of, you know, film IMDb. Documentary that I ever shot, which was called Samsara.
And so was that connected to this?
Well, no,
at all,
not directly. See, I was already working on this film. I was doing research, and I was starting to film a family in Rochester, and I wasn't really a cinematographer then. I was a filmmaker, I was becoming a filmmaker, and I hired a cameraman and a crew and, you know, as much as I knew and tried to explain what I was looking for and in terms of, you know, trying to find relationships with the camera. And what was interesting is that when the dailies came back, they were beautifully shot, beautifully executed, but they didn't really say anything. And I, at that time, I kind of didn't really know what that meant. So I didn't know really how to verbalize what I was looking for, which is very interesting because that's what happens with directors now that I work with on, you know, in studio movies even, where, you know, it's trying to find a way to verbalize what's in their mind's eye. So I took the camera myself, and I didn't really know that much about shooting, but I knew about photography, and I started shooting myself, in a sense, and looking for that idea of what creates meaning and how do you create meaning with the camera and how do you create meaning with, you know, panning from one thing to the other, to the person, and connecting them in the space and within the shot, and it says something. So that's how I actually started shooting, and so this film, in a way, became my palette. that I started shaping over the years, and working with Tavi and creating stories, because I was writing a lot of poetry at the time. And I actually met Tavi when I was already filming this other family, and I wanted to learn how to speak Lao. So his name was given to me, and I called him up, and you know, he was kind of shocked, like, you know, who are you, and do you even know where Laos is? Because most people don't even know where Laos is. And I said, yeah, I know where Laos is, and I know the whole history, and you know, I really want to learn the language, because I think that the language is a portal to a person's way of being and their mind's eye and what their beliefs are. And I was interested in getting into the worldview and making a film that was not a traditional documentary, but which was a film about memory and a film about how you can vicariously experience what the character is experiencing, as if to shoot their point of view and what they're experiencing and feeling, and then they walk into that point of view. And so, but I didn't intellectually understand all of this. I was kind of on this search of trying to put something together.
And so is there another film out there in this film footage that you've shot over all these years that has a different point of view, has a different perspective?
Well, you know, it's interesting because even though all the years, and of course I've shot over 35 movies in the course of making this film, you know, I always went back to the film as a way of going back to myself in a way. And, you know, there's a lot of material. There's enough material, let's say, to make several movies. But I have to say that the heart and soul of what the movie is and what it's about, I think, is in this film, in the film that we made, The Betrayal. You know, and when you think about it, trying to distill, you know, over 23 years of material into a story, a dramatic line that has a balance of the political and the personal, and be able to move people, you know, it's quite a daunting challenge, you know. And I think that was our greatest challenge, was to how to tell the political story, but it being a very personal story. And I think that that's ultimately what's so amazing about the film, is that it's a family drama. You know, it's a love story. It's so many different facets of one's life, and so many people take away something and say, "Oh my God, you know, I called my mother for the first time in 10 years." And you know, it makes people think.
Was there a moment where you felt like you've figured it out, where you said, "Okay, now let's change direction and go," you know, I don't know whether it was the voiceover or the idea of him telling the narrative. Was there a moment where it kind of congealed for you?
Yes. Actually, the moment it congealed for me was when I was struggling with trying to figure out the different voices in the film, the historical voice, the voice of the past, and the voice of prophecy and our future, and the universal voice of us, and then the voice, and then Tommy's voice as someone who, as someone who is telling his own personal story. And the moment that I realized, and I said to Tavi, I said, you know, we've never interviewed your mother. And your mother has experienced so much of the same things that you have, but has such a different perspective on it. And it's almost like our mothers that we take for granted. You know, they're always there and they're always supporting us, but we never bother to ask them what their opinion is. And so we did an interview with Tavi's mother. And after that interview, we both said, yes, you know, we have the movie. You know, she said so much of what we had been trying to say through, you know, the footage and trying to put together the story, and she was able to just open up her heart and tell us this incredible story.
Though even what she doesn't say is a very important part of the movie, I think.
Yeah.
Because there's so much going on. That experience, I think, with all of our mothers as well. Because, you know, what really happened, you know, do we want to know, do we not want to know?
It's true. And, you know, Tommy's mother is very much like, for me, the universal mother. Like you're saying, you know, like our mothers, and that, you know, when she says, you know, the children want to go away, she says, they say they have wings and a tail. They say, I have wings and a tail. I can fly away. I can do whatever I want. And to me, that's every parent, you know, it's when their children want to leave them. And that's her tragedy, that she brought them here to this country to save them, and then they leave her. And it's almost like any parent that raises their children to save them and protect them, and then they go away. They leave the nest.
Well, even her journey of trying to kind of hope that some of things come back. You know, the continuing loss, even after she had all these losses, she somehow manages to lose, like, her husband a second time in the course of this process. It's kind of horrifying.
Yeah. Well, I don't talk about that too much because it's part of the plot.
Damn it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the thing about Tavi's mother is that she goes through all of these emotional upheavals, and she, there are twists and turns in the movie that we can't believe, and that people actually can't believe that both Tavi and I were there and were able to capture this. But, you know, I have to thank, you know, whoever is watching us, that, you know, during those certain moments, you know, Tavi called me and I was able to go and film them, and we were able to witness, in a way, what was going on. And there's certain events that happened that we just didn't expect, that were, I just, were shocking to me. And then other events where I couldn't even, I wasn't there, and he had to take the Hi8 camera and film it himself.
Well, it's funny because we were, in terms of hiding the secrets and not, you know, giving away too much about the movie, I guess my experience of a lot of movies, and particularly documentary, is that in some ways it's the second and third and fourth viewing of these films that it really, particularly a film as complex as this, that really it starts to resonate in a more profound way. It's almost like culturally how we watch movies has changed so much, and particularly with docs now.
That's very true. And I'm you know, I have to say thank you for recognizing that this is a complex film. That is not a film that just spews out information. And, you know, it's interesting to see how documentaries have changed over the years and what documentaries are for. Documentary genre is so different. There are so many different kinds of documentary. Mm-hmm. And I this film gives information, but there's a lot of information in the images, in the way that things are put together, in the sound effects. Mm-hmm. And it's almost like a narrative film in that way, in that part of the thing about the visuals is that I really wanted to use what's called visual metaphor. Mm-hmm. I wanted the images to have as much weight as what was being said, and that you know, I wasn't going. We didn't edit it like most traditional documentaries, where you would take all of the voiceovers and all of the interviews, and then look at them, cut them and paste them, and put them all together, and just say, okay, this is what that's what said, that's what said, that's what said, and then put the images to that to illustrate it. What I wanted to do is to, you know, go the other way around, is to make it all together so that, almost like a narrative film where, you know, you cut to an image and there's no words and there's no sound. So that silence can speak as much as the words. And that's very unconventional for documentary. I mean, documentaries today so often are fast cut, and there's tons of information. Mm-hmm. And yes, they're very informative, and they give you lots of information, but do they resonate with you afterwards, and do they move you emotionally to reflect upon your own life? And that's what we really wanted this film to do.
Well, the flip side of it is now that everybody is kind of shooting their docs to look like an HBO doc or look like a PBS doc, and so they can sell it to PBS or HBO, or they already have. So you go to Sundance and you see all these films that look the same, and there can be great stories and fascinating moments, and yet the palette, the visual palette, is so consistently the same that it's aggravating after a while. And you definitely don't do that here. I mean, you definitely shoot it like a movie.
Well, very interestingly, when I first started shooting this film and I started showing people parts of it, they would say to me, oh, it looks too beautiful to be real. Is this really a documentary? Is that really real? I was like, yeah, that's what I do. If I'm shooting a documentary, if I'm shooting a film for someone, you know, I'm not going to make it look bad just so that people believe it's real. I'm going to make it look the way it should for that particular story. Yeah. And that's the thing about this film, is that I use all different mediums to tell the story. There are parts in the film where I was recreating a memory, and I shot it in film. And I shot it in Hi8 because I wanted to be able to choose which one felt to me to be more honest and more integral and authentic to the moment. And I ended up using the Hi8. Now, I'm a DP. I'm a director of photography. I would want to use the highest quality material, maybe, but maybe not. You know, it's like when I was shooting Eternal Sunshine with Michel Gondry. There were moments in the film where I decided not to use movie lights in many moments, or when we were using the memory light, it was just, you know, we just rigged a, a light on top of the camera. I mean, we had to figure out exactly what light that was going to be, but it was very, very basic. And, you know, no professional, you know, like the key light wasn't coming to you on the side and the big soft bounce, a muzz bounce, but it felt very real to the movie.
Was that a new experience in film? I mean, it seems to me like, interestingly enough, Speed Racer, which was a financial disaster, but I think is, you know, pushed the envelope a lot, that Wachowskis always do, but even Gondry and Beacon Rewind, which you shot, you know, that was in 17 different places in terms of the visual style. I mean, that was all over the place intentionally, but always consistently what it was, you know, trying to be. But it's fascinating to watch directors now with their DPs working towards this kind of mixed use of all the different forms, because everybody was so busy saying, well, digital's coming, it's all about digital, it's all about digital, that they kind of forgot that I think it was just a tool and not the answer to every question.
I agree. You know, I've not been a huge advocate of just jumping into the digital pool. Mm-hmm. Ever since I shot, you know, Personal Velocity, everybody said, oh, you know, you're involved in digital. And I said, no, I shot Personal Velocity in digital because we had to. Mm-hmm. And then they said, oh, but you made it look so good. And I said, but that's the point. You know, if you can make digital, you know, look as it's supposed to look, mm-hmm. not to be something else, but you use it as a tool. Mm-hmm. And, you know, today we use it as a tool. I go into the digital realm mm-hmm. in post, which is how I was able to put this film together. Mm-hmm. Because for years I thought, oh my God, I would have nightmares about how am I going to cut all of this negative? How am I going to find these shots? Because, you mm-hmm. know, this film, as I joke with the Kodak guys, is like the history of Kodak film stock. You know what I mean? I count 12 different kinds of film stock that we used in the film over the years. Mm. But, you know, how do you go back and cut that negative when you don't have the digital reference to it, which everybody uses now?
Right.
So, but we were able to do that. Well, you know, fortunately, you know, we had Deluxe Film Labs helped us enormously. I mean, they just opened up their doors and said, however we can help you make this film, we believe in it and we want to help you make it. And they were incredible. They helped us to organize all the material and we put it all in the digital realm, meaning I did transfers with all the 16 material. We up-resed all of the video material. Mm-hmm. The Super 8, I had already optically blown up to 16. Mm-hmm. Do you want to change the light? See, of course, me being the DP, I see the cloud come over. Cut! Okay.
Oh, like that. It's like magic.
Right, exactly. See, I'm like, all right, bring the 18K in.
See, that does work for you.
David, anytime you want me to light your interviews.
You can come along anytime you
want,
believe me.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's so funny.
Deluxe was helping you out.
And they really helped us to put all of the elements together and to figure out how to online it to match back to what we had done in the offline. So, you know, it was a challenge. But I have to say it was a learning experience for me, too, because, you know, as I've become a DP, as I am a DP over the years, what's interesting is that one learns to, when in editing, I can look at a scene and I can dissect the scene and put it together and edit it in my mind and edit it in as a cinematographer in terms of what shots we need and understand the scene. But when you go and step back and look at the whole movie, it's a whole other point of view, which is the realm of the director, you know, where you take the step back and you see the arc of the film and you're able to understand the nuance and when the nuance comes in and the pacing and how to influence that pacing. So for me, it was a real great learning experience to put this film together. You know, I mean, I've come out of it a different person now that I had to take the time to do it, to finish it. Because over the years, it was always kind of a personal project I was working on with Tavi. And we would work together and it was almost like a dialogue over the years, and really enjoyable dialogue of talking about ideas and how to put them together and images. And then I realized that it was really time to finish the film because the war in Iraq was heating up. And also, I just felt like the world really needs to see this film. The world really needs to hear this film and hear from us. So it was
difficult.
There's
something about family. There's something going on. I don't know exactly what it is, and it's almost hard to encapsulate. But in feature films, as well as documentaries, there seems to be this real moment where family, you know, people need to talk about families and have this discussion. And and try to figure out how we're supposed to interact again. Seems like somewhere we lost it in the Bush administration years. It kind of disappeared in the last 2 years. There's been movie after movie about families and how those things are structured.
Well, it's interesting with this family because in Laos, family is the center of the world. I mean, the temple and the family is the center of everything, as it is with many traditional families. You know, when you look outside of America and you look at Latin America or you look at parts of Europe, and it's almost like old world Europe where, you know, people enjoyed their lives. They enjoyed their families. They took the time to sit with their families. They cared about their old people. They, they didn't work themselves to death. The money wasn't the end all. Mm-hmm. And now it's interesting because I think our generation is beginning to rethink. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm at the end of the baby boomer generation. And yet I see how many people went out to make money and to succeed. And, it's very interesting that now all of a sudden they're stopping and saying, oh, wait a minute, you know, I missed the boat. You know, what about our families? We're all separated. We're all over the place. People don't, you know, meet with other people. And I think it's kind of, it's interesting to see how a traditional family breaks apart in this society. And the bonds of family break apart, and it reminds us about what we've lost.
Yeah. Well, it seems to me like everything has become a little too easy. You know, we're watching our economy crumble at the moment, but at the same time, all the toys that we have that, you know, our parents didn't have. I'm probably around the same age you are, and you know, my father watched, you know, had the Model A and, you know, Model T when he was a kid, and which was a used car back then, thank God. He's not quite that old, but, you know, but went through the invention of television and went through the, you know, the rocket to the moon really meaning something to him. And, you know, here we are with the computers and the ability to, even in my lifetime, to go from the letter to the fax machine to the email is to the things we carry around all day long. It's such a huge difference and yet somehow incredibly disconnected at the same time.
Well, just think about just today. I mean, how many emails did you look at before I walked in the door? And then we both were checking our emails before we came to sit down here. And I think that, you know, so many people now are using these devices to communicate and they forget about talking to the person themselves. Sometimes I see people emailing across the, you know, when I'm production. And you go into the production office and there's two people and they're emailing each other and they're facing each other and they're 3 feet away. And you go like, what's happened to our society?
Yeah.
You know, where are we going? And emails, I don't have time to answer 70 emails that I get every day. Mm-hmm. And when I'm shooting, if I'm on a 16, 17 hour day and I get home, I spend 2 or 3 hours, if I have the energy, answering emails. And then if I don't, everybody's like, why didn't you answer my email? Right. And I feel like, what are we creating here as a society, this society of guilt and having to be on spot for everyone else? You're immediately accountable to everybody else because they can send you an email or a text, especially a text, because it's like they know you get it right away. And so, you know, I sort of feel like, you know, in making this film, I was kind of going back to what are the values and what are, you know, what... It's things that I think sitting down and talking to a person and talking about ideas and talking about creativity and making things again with people in person. Yeah. Shocking.
Well, I believe I'm a big proponent of the slow internet. It hasn't really taken hold yet, but, you know, the idea that everything you had to be the first to do this, the first to do that, and then you realize at some point that there's value inherent to what you do that's not about being the first one and it's not about being the... You know, and even now, as we see the breakdown of the media, there's, you know, being at the biggest newspaper, being at the biggest media outlet, whatever it is, you know, there's certain value to the size and scale.
Right.
But then there's certain value to doing it well or having the emotional experience. And I think we're seeing with, you know, documentaries, if you look at the last few years of the films the Academy Awards have ended up going for, they've been slower paced. They've been more, you know, specific personal stories that that find some sort of emotional pound. You know, there's something, some weight there, and not just kind of these great machines of the ability to, you know, yet the things that are those tool machines, you know, that are great effects pieces are also fun, but there's not, those are too easy somehow.
Yeah, there's not, you don't have the time to absorb the resonance of it or to feel that. And I think that's, you know, that's a really good point about the about our film, is that we didn't want to make it fast-paced. It's Lao. The Laotians are Asian, the Lao take their time. It's about, mm-hmm. it's almost like Japanese films, you know, the Ozu mm-hmm. films and Kurosawa film. They aren't fast cut. I mean, they really allow yourself to take the time to allow the shots to begin and end. And that's the thing about Tavi, and he really understood this. As the editor, understood the idea of how I shot and understood mm-hmm. that every shot to me has a beginning, a middle, and an end. Mm-hmm. It has a story to tell. And to not cut the shot before it's over mm-hmm. because you're in a hurry to get to the next thing. And that's the whole thing is about the film kind of takes you over. In the beginning, you know, mm-hmm. you're like, it's okay, where are we going, where are we going? And then all of a sudden you get swept up into it mm-hmm. In its own pacing, you know? Yeah. So it's interesting that, you know, that has become, you know, a trend that people are saying, no, we're not going to buy this going mm-hmm. on the treadmill so fast that let's look at real stories and stories that are being told.
Well, I think the challenge, and particularly in documentary, but in a lot of films, is getting people into the movie theater.
Yeah.
Because that experience of being in that room in the dark, kind of, you're expecting to take your time. You're expecting to have the experience. As soon as you stick it in the DVD player in your television set, you know, I guess more people are turning off the lights in the room, but it's hard to keep that concentration when the email is going, you know, you hear the email binging in the next
exactly.
room.
Exactly.
And yet it's the great joy of being able to have the access. So it's this real dichotomy, I think, that...
It is, and you know what, I realize that, you know, for as busy as we are, busy as we are going into the movie theater, I find it's become for me that escape, you know, mm-hmm. I really enjoy being able to turn everything off. It's like being on the plane, you know, yeah. you cannot be on your cell phone.
It's like, does anybody really want internet access on the airplane? It's the last
no.
place you can go and hide.
I know. But it's so true about being in the movie theater, and that's the hardest... That's our big challenge here right mm-hmm. now with the documentary is how to get people in the theaters to watch a documentary. Yeah. But in a way, this film is not just a documentary, it's a film. And that's the thing mm-hmm. that I appreciated people saying when they first saw the film when they walked out. They said to me, this is pure cinema. I mean, mm-hmm. this is a film. And I had to laugh because I said, yeah, it's a film.
So for you, you've now slide between the worlds of, you know, mainstream films, art films, documentaries, commercials even that you do some work on.
Yeah.
Are they all different muscle groups for you, or have you kind of found a way to synthesize into kind of a general way of working for yourself and a way of seeing them as a DP?
Well, you know, for me as a DP, you know, seeing all these different kind of films, I kind of go to it with that each of them are different, that they each are such different stories. And how do I bring what my mind and my mind's eye into all of these different stories? So for me, they in a way, my work is very eclectic because mm-hmm. the kind of projects I work on are very eclectic. You know, like you're saying, music films and going mm-hmm. and doing a couple of music films, you know, shooting with Julian Sobel to do with Lou Reed and doing Berlin. Mm-hmm. To me, that was a special project because I was really interested in music and how to make these paintings with Julian of this mm-hmm. movie. You know, so it became a creative endeavor. And each project for me, even if it's a commercial, mm-hmm. you know, becomes a challenge, a creative challenge for me of, you know, how can I paint this picture? Mm-hmm. How can I... you know, give a different perspective on this and work with the director or if I'm the director, you know, the director DP, you know, what do I want to say and what's in my mind's eye? Mm-hmm. You know, and so it's, you know, it's exciting for me because it changes all the time mm-hmm. and directors are all different and they all have different personalities.
It was almost shocking to me to see that you were running around with an actual camera as a camera person on... The Shine a Light documentary for Scorsese.
Oh, yeah, that was hilarious. That was one of the best shoots I've ever been on in my
really?
Life. Oh, we had such a great time because there were 16 DPs on the movie. And poor Bob Richardson had to deal with all the lighting and everything. We went off as if we were the kids having fun. You know, there's five Academy Award-winning DPs there, and we were all having so much fun. We were like, oh, what time do we have to be back in from lunch? You know, going off to the bar.
And you just did it because it was the joy of doing it, or because Marty asked? Or?
Yeah, I mean, you know, to have an opportunity to work with Marty was amazing. I mean, Marty is such an amazing person, such an amazing director. You know, having worked with him on several projects now, and I'm actually working on one with him right now. Mm-hmm. And it's just, I learn so much every day from him, and he's got such a great heart. And he is hilarious. And I just feel like I want to shoot the best I can for you. You know, mm. I want him to really look at it and enjoy it and to find something new in it. Mm. And so that's what channel light was for me. It was like, Marty, you know, I'm there for you. Whenever you need me, I'm there for you. Mm.
So when you were a kid, did you just know that you would find some sort of some sort of creative outlet that you had to find a way? Or did you know that it was a visual thing for you early on? Or...
Well, you know, when I was a kid, I wanted to be a sculptor. And yet, you know, I was in this family where my father was, okay, you have to, you know, pushing us to go into some sort of profession. You know, mm. In the end, the only one who ended up going into the profession was my younger sister, who's a doctor. Mm. But, you know, my brother's in the arts. He runs all of the theaters for the University of Michigan. Mm-hmm. And my sister's a musician, of course. And he's still asking us when we're going to get real jobs. But... you know, I wanted to be a sculptor, and I was doing things in the basement all the time. I was mm. always working with my father around the house and fixing things and making things. And it wasn't until I got to college, when I went to Brown, that I thought that I wanted to be an Egyptologist. Mm. I was really interested in history and the ancient world and something to do with the texture of it, I guess, because I was really interested in the art. Mm. And... I took a photography, I wanted to take a sculpture class at the Rhode Island School of Design. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't get into the class because I was I was a Brown student, so I was at the end of the line. Mm-hmm. And so I took a photography class. And I can't tell you, I mean, it opened up a whole other world to me. It was the first time that I looked at light in that way. Mm-hmm. That I looked at, you know, the way that the light falls on the table or the way, you know, the sun moves and it changes. And it's the first time I actually... We focused my attention on it, and all of a sudden I saw this whole other world. And part of that was because in my room I had these glass jars against the window, and the shade was pulled down, and the sun used to come in every morning and refract through the glass and throw these refractions on the shade and in the room. And I remember photographing that. It was the first thing I ever photographed because I was so interested in that light. And and that's kind of how why I'm here.
It really is about perspective. It really is about making about what your view is of the universe as an artist, isn't it? I mean, that's it's always interesting. People say, what's the difference between with all these cell cameras and, you know, all this stuff around? You think, what's the difference between all this stuff on YouTube and what you do? And I always think the first big thing is intent.
Yeah.
You know, it's you mean to be doing something other than just, you know, copying an event that you happen to see with your eye. You're adding to it.
It's true, and it's what you want to say with that. It's like, what is the meaning? What is the message? Mm. You know, that ultimately is, you can put, like you're saying, you can put anything up there, but, you know, what's the perspective, the unique perspective?
Mm-hmm. So you're not going to make us wait 25 more years for another documentary, are you?
No. I don't know if I'm going to do a documentary the next time. I mean, I'm kind of interested in doing more unusual kinds of projects, and I'm sure that surprises you. you know, doing some dramatic projects, but also doing... I'm interested in working also with musicians and some composers and putting together some you know, smaller projects of music films. Mm-hmm. Not music videos. I'm still kind of exploring it. Howard Shore and I were talking about it because... Mm. And Michelle is also very interested in this whole idea of the intersection of music and visuals and how to visually describe music. And so for me, it's something that, you know, I probably would go into as a...
My BlackBerry went off.
Notice how he doesn't turn his BlackBerry off.
I was vibrating.
Well, I'm actually quite impressed that during the past half an hour it hasn't buzzed.
I guess that says it all.
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you for taking the time. It's been a real pleasure.
Thank you. Yeah.